now, sir. We're closed, sir. You'll have to finish your calling outside.
Out, out, brief candle.
Catherine Dolan runs this store with her mother. Both are widows. The mother holds the place down in the morning. Miss Dolan holds it down until 6 o'clock when they close. She was closing when she spotted a man in the phone booth. She checked and he put a gun on her. He sapped her. She thinks it was a sandbag.
Serious?
She has her own doctor with her now. He says she'll be okay. Get the cash register for around $300. Spell it back here by the counter, saw the man leave the store. That's all the dope we have on him.
We'll talk to him.
Lawrence Hope. Larry, meet Lieutenant Guthrie, Inspector Grab.
Oh, you're detectives, huh? That's the job I got my sights lined on. For when I really settle down, you know?
Yeah, well, it's not much like you see in the movies.
Oh, I know. I'm not fooled by those private eyes and that stuff. Dame on every corner, super sleuth. Stuff like in this magazine here. No, I know police work is hard. And it's the details that count. Like when you work on a jigsaw puzzle, that's hard too. But when you get it all together, you really feel like you've done something, you know?
Suppose you just tell us what you saw.
Well, I was just walking past and I saw this man walk out of here. It was a little past six. I thought that was kind of funny because Kitty, oh, she's the owner here. She always locks up at six sharp. And after that, she's got to let you out herself if you're still in here.
Well, what did this man look like?
I couldn't tell. Just a man. He wore a hat and a suit.
Or did he have a limp or anything out of the ordinary?
No. He was awfully tall, though, if that's any help. Oh, over 6'2", I'd say.
But you didn't see his face, huh?
No, couldn't make it out.
How about a car?
No, he just walked off down the street. I began to get worried when Kitty didn't show up, so I came in here to investigate. I found her lying back there by the telephone. Oh, I didn't touch her or anything like that. I know better than that. I just called you guys.
Lieutenant, Doc says you can talk to Miss Dolan now, but take it easy.
Okay. You stick around, Larry. How do you feel now, Miss Dolan?
Scrambled.
Shocked more than anything else. I'll x-ray tomorrow, but I think she was only knocked out.
Only, he says. Only. Have you ever been knocked out?
Yeah, I have.
Did Mother know about this?
No. You asked me not to tell her.
Good. I'll tell her when it won't upset her.
Well, do you feel up to telling us what happened?
Well, he just held a gun on me and hit me, that's all. But he didn't need a weapon with a face like he had. It was horrible. Deformed.
You mean birthmarks?
No, no. His head was little. Shrunk out of shape like a Mongolian mummy or something. I never saw anything like it before.
Well, how tall a man would you say he was?
I don't know. Like I say, I couldn't see anything but that awful face. Besides, he was in the booth.
He was wearing a hat?
Yes. Look, why don't you just find him? A man like that couldn't get far without people staring at him. He isn't human.
And you didn't notice him when he came in the store?
No. Isn't that funny? There were quite a few customers just before I closed, but why wouldn't they notice him?
Must have been wearing a disguise, a mask, or some kind of makeup.
Mm. No, no, he wasn't.
Well, he could have put it on when he was in the phone booth.
It was a real face. The eyes looked at me and the lips moved when he spoke to me.
What did he say to you?
Out, out, brief candle.
What?
Just before he hit me. It was a real face. A nightmare, a freak.
It's all right, Kitty.
Got some?
Really much. We have to start somewhere. This whole thing has such a theatrical ring to it, the horror mask and the quotation from Shakespeare.
Yeah.
You know, a couple of years ago, when you were in New York on that extradition, we had a case involving an alleged poet named Tracy Powers. He also was quite an artist at making rubber masks, death masks, things like that. His real name was Eli Worth. He's been on the shady side ever since he arrived in this town 16 years ago. He has no visible means of support. But there's one thing that he hates worse than poison.
What's that?
Work. He'll do anything to avoid it.
What's his record?
Had 15 arrests, one conviction. I settled him in county for a year.
What for?
Slugged a man in a brawl with a sandbag.
Is he in town now?
Back about 18 months. Here, take a look at him. Another thing, he's over 6 foot 2 inches tall.
Yeah.
Well, Lieutenant Guthrie.
Or is it Captain by now?
I'm still Lieutenant. This is Inspector Greb.
Hey, won't you gentlemen come in? This is a rough neighborhood. I could use some protection. I assume this is a social call since I haven't been misbehaving lately.
No. That's only to look at. If you'd been any kind of a detective, you would have observed that it has no real legs.
If we came for some technical advice, Tracy, do you still have the same genius for making masks?
Genius? Well, thank you, Lieutenant. I never dreamed you cared.
You're pretty good, huh?
I think so. Say, you've got an interesting face for a mask, Inspector. I'd like to work on you sometime. Of course, I'd build up the nose a little bit, and I'd hollow out the cheeks, but it'd be very interesting.
Could you make him look like a Mongolian mummy?
Are there such things?
We'll get back to that. What have you been doing for a living lately?
The usual.
Unemployed?
Between publishers would be kinder.
The lieutenant tells me that you were the guest of the county for a while.
For one loathsome year.
Had any kind of a job since you got out?
You mean a menial salaried position? No.
Well, that's been over 18 months.
Has it really? I hadn't kept track.
Well, how do you live? The money must come from someplace.
How artists survive is a mystery that shall remain forever unexplained to the layman, Lieutenant. It's even a mystery to us.
What kind of an artist are you, Tracy?
Well, besides making masks, I have a talent for creating and reciting poetry.
Well, how do you pay your rent?
My landlady is more concerned with when.
What was the last thing you had published?
Inspector, great poets are seldom recognized before their death.
What did you do last night?
Well, I worked on this and I read.
Can you prove it?
So, am I under suspicion for something? Hey, aren't you a little nosy, Inspector?
Oh, we brought a paper with us.
All right, let's have it. What am I supposed to have done?
What a nice suit you got here, Tracy. Oh! A couple more nice suits, huh?
I can afford 3 nice suits like these. How do you afford them?
I buy them secondhand. Sometimes people give me things.
Well, I can't figure out how a man who hasn't worked in 18 months could have 3 new suits.
Where'd you get that? I thought you had learned your lesson about sandbags by now.
This is a pretty rough neighborhood. These hands aren't made for fighting. I never carried on the street. Man's got a right to have an equalizer in his own home.
Let's take a ride, Tracy.
First time I've been in one of these rooms. Big operation, huh? What do I look for, Lieutenant?
But we're just going to look at some general suspects. If you see anyone that looks like someone you know, why tell Inspector Ashby. You near-sighted or far-sighted?
Near, and I know what you're thinking. I didn't have them on last night.
All right, Bob, bring them on.
moving along. Pick out a square up there. Put both feet on it. Put your hands to your side. Look straight ahead. First man is Joe Toby, assaulted with a deadly weapon. Arresting officers caught Joe beating up a man with a hunk of lead pipe. All right, step out where we can see you, Joe. Now tell us where you live.
I ain't got no permanent address, just general delivery. And I'm in here on account of an accident.
What kind of accident?
That piece of pipe just fell from somewhere, that's all.
And how come your fingerprints are on it?
Look, I'm getting a little sick of this. This is the third time I've been framed.
No, the voice I heard was younger.
Take off your hat. Step back. The next man is Tracy Powers. Vagrancy. Step out. What do you do for a living?
Nothing. And I'm a qualified expert at it.
Same build, Lieutenant. Tall like that. I can't be sure.
Didn't you tell us earlier that you were a poet?
I did.
It might be the same voice, but I couldn't swear either way.
All right, Tracy, let's hear you sing Out, Out, Brief Candle for us.
I beg your pardon?
You know Shakespeare, Out, Out, Brief Candle?
Oh. Specifically, that's Macbeth, Inspector. It begins, tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day.
Tracy, all we want is Out, Out, Brief Candle.
You embarrass me, Inspector. The context of poetry as fine as this should never be broken. Creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow. A poor player who struts and frets his art upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
Step back.
He's good.
Both witnesses admit Tracy could be our man.
But we can't hold him on what we've got. We've been talking to him for an hour in the city prison. Got no place. Let him go.
You know any other man 6 feet two could know that much about masks?
Lieutenant Guthrie. Yeah? Where? We'll get right on. For the robbery and sandbagging.
Where?
American Salvage. Said he looked like a mummy. Clancy, what happened?
He was beaten up pretty badly. I got a statement from him before they got here.
What's the gist of it?
Name is Adams. He's a bookkeeper. He was working in the office here, going over the day's receipts. All once he turned around, came face to face with a mummy. Well, that's what the guy said he looked like. And the mummy sandbagged him. And when he didn't knock him out with the first blow, the mummy really laid it on. He didn't see very much.
Anybody else see the mummy?
Yeah, Barney Gardner. He's the owner of the place. He surprised him while he was pounding on Adams. He got away. Here's Mr. Gardner now.
Oh, the inspectors are here, huh?
Mr. Gardner, Lieutenant Guthrie, Inspector Grant.
Hi. Oh, gee, that's a shame about Adam. He's the best man I ever had.
You want to tell us what happened today, Mr. Gardner?
Not much to tell. I walked in the office here and I saw this guy just clobbering Adams. Pulled a gun on me before I knew what was up.
You know what he looked like?
He's the ugliest man I ever saw. Something over his skin, I don't know, something like yellow gauze.
Yellow gauze?
Yeah, it pulled his skin tight. Funny-looking stuff. Silk, maybe it was nylon.
Could it have been a lady's silk stocking?
Eh?
A woman's silk stocking.
Yeah, now that you mentioned it, it could have been... His hat would have covered the foot part.
Yeah, well, is there anything else you can tell us? How tall was the man?
About my height, about 5'9".
At the front door, so we came around here. I'm Lieutenant Guthrie. This is Inspector Greb with police officers.
Oh, are you the police who were working with Larry on that Dolan case?
That's right, Mr. Cole.
Well, I'm afraid you caught him out. He just admitted lab. Was it anything important?
We just wanted to verify his report.
You know there's an ordinance against open fires, Ms. Hope?
Well, it's just a little fire. Larry cleaned his room.
Oh, I'll put it out for you. I'd be more careful of it in the future.
You know, I'm right lucky to have a son like Larry. Never any bother at all. Hand me that basket, will you, mister? What'd you say your name was?
Guthrie, Lieutenant Guthrie.
Oh, there's a town in Oklahoma called Guthrie.
Ben. Excuse me.
My, I never saw a body make such a fuss over a little fire. It's not like the house was burning down.
Okay.
When I was a girl, yes. It was accustomed to burn house trash this time of
American
year.
American Salvage Company.
Been any help to you, gentlemen?
Oh, quite a bit, Mrs. Hope. Has Larry ever been in trouble?
Oh, never any bother to anyone. You know, he graduated a straight A student. You never know about all the slang he uses. He never puts on airs.
Does he have any hobbies?
Just one. Reads all his spare time.
What does he read? Mysteries?
Oh, everything. Right now he's on the classics like Shaw and Shakespeare.
Does he have many girlfriends?
No, he never chases. Says most of the girls he knows are too silly. He'll end up marrying Nob Hill, I'll just bet you.
How about a buddy?
No, he keeps to himself most of the time.
And where did you say he was now?
Well, I really don't know.
Well, when he comes back, would you tell him we'd like to talk to him?
Yeah, I certainly will.
Thank you.
Caravel 2 and 3, burglary in progress, Lakeshore Plaza. Respond immediately.
That's us.
The other guy took a shot at me, and then you fellas arrived.
We'll go around back. There are more cars on the way. Soon got a load on all points out and a stakeout in his home.
Then you know who it is?
Yeah, we think so. Larry Hope.
What's the matter?
Larry Hope's waiting right here in the office. Says he's got a clue for you.
Thanks, Bert.
Hi, Larry.
Thought I'd pay you a call. Think I may have a clue for you.
Oh?
Saw some kids playing in the street and got the idea. You know how they like to dress up real crazy, you know? Well, this bunch were all wearing stockings over their faces. Look like Halloween. You'd be surprised what a stocking can do to a face. I'll just bet that's what your man was wearing.
Got it all figured out, have you?
Well, I've given it some thought. For instance, maybe he wasn't 6'2" like I thought. Maybe he was wearing those built-up shoes. They sell them now, you know.
Now, you make him sound real clever.
What about it, Larry? Was he a clever master criminal or just a lucky thug?
Oh, I don't know. But you guys have to admit he's had you going in circles so far.
Hmm? How long do you think he'll get away with it?
Not for long. If he keeps on operating the way he has.
What does that mean?
Well, a man can pull two or three jobs and get away with it for good. But if he continues to follow in the same pattern, then the cops are bound to figure ahead of him. Right?
You read that somewhere, did you?
Yeah. By a retired police captain. Makes sense.
But if the criminal continues to switch his method of operating, he can keep the police confused, is that it?
Well, the captain didn't write about that. But it makes sense, doesn't it? Say, why are you guys so grim? Oh, am I getting out of line talking like this?
What are your new plans, Larry?
What was that, Lieutenant?
You heard it right.
It's all over, Larry. Stand up. Stand up. You got yourself in a pack of trouble, boy.
I don't know what you're talking about.
You read it all in books. Don't you know what happens when you lose?
What do you think you got on me anyway? That doesn't prove anything. Anybody could have thrown him into my backyard and burned him there. It's never locked.
We didn't say anything about them being in your backyard, Larry.
I guess I wasn't as smart as I thought I was.
Salutations, gentlemen.
Oh, all right, Tracy. Is this a social or business call?
No, I'm informed by the newspapers that you've got Larry Hope in Durant's file.
Well, he's in Mendocino. He'll get psychological rehabilitation there.
The fate of the nonconformist, dwell within the stagnant mold of society or be destroyed.
That's why you came here, to give us your ideas on the penal system?
No, hardly. Sit down, gentlemen, huh? No. Really, to deliver these. Your invitations to the wedding of Miss Kitty Dolan, bookstore proprietor, and Tracy Powers, poet extraordinaire.
Well, that's wonderful. How'd this come about?
Well, you recall that superb reading I gave while in your lineup.
Yes, yes, it was very impressive.
Well, thank you. It so impressed Miss Dolan that she pursued me ever since. I finally capitulated. You know, gentlemen, I've always been aware of my genius as a reader of poetry. But I wonder...
You wonder what?
Could it be possible that, for the first time in my life, I was too good? See you in church.